anyways, my name's Katie, by the way. People give me way more credit than I actually deserve. But this is a Smarter Store visit. Like Rich said, it's a methodology that is across our entire program. It started from the corporate aspect, and we've infiltrated it pretty much regardless of what team you're on within MarketStar or Create. You're going to go through this. So how many people here have heard of the Smarter methodology before? Show of hands. Cool. What can you tell me about it? That doesn't sound like an answer. Come on. What can you tell me about it? In the back. Start with a plan. Okay. All right. So in our job, it's probably a good idea to have a plan before we just show up at a store, right?
Yeah.
Cool. Good idea. What else? Come on. There was more hands that were raised than that. You guys are leaving me hanging. Remember, this is live in Korea. I'm just kidding. Come on. What else? What do methodologies usually entail? What is the point of them?
Utilize your time and the store rep's time most efficiently.
Yeah, we want to maximize their time, right? Nobody likes having their time wasted, correct?
Right.
Who in here, by show of hands, likes when people waste their time? Awesome, nobody. So here's what I want to guarantee you for the next 3 hours. We have 3 hours together, people. I'm not going to waste your time, all right? If you feel like you're going to fall asleep or your head is going to bob or something, please avoid that at all costs. If you need to, I don't care if you stand up in the back of the room. Okay, do whatever it is that you need to do in order to stay engaged. All right? Okay, so Smarter is a methodology that we're going to use. Here's what I can guarantee you. If you use this, you will be successful in your job. This is literally the key to success. If you don't use this, you will not be successful in your job. You'll probably flounder and get by for a little while. Eventually, you'll get caught. Like Rich said, this is something that your managers come out and look for, right? Does anybody remember what percentage is based on using the Smarter Visit methodology?
20%.
How much?
120%.
15?
65?
10? I heard a 10. It's 10. 10%, okay? This plays into essentially how we rate your ability to do your job. So I would say this is pretty darn important, okay? 10% adds up over time. How many of you guys have been in sales before? 10% is a lot, right? You can make a lot of money off of 10%, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's make the client a lot of money using this 10% by incorporating this methodology. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Yay, okay. So every time, did I just hear an oh wow?
Hola.
Oh, okay, cool. All right. Hola. I like it. Okay. So whenever we see this slide in the future, there's going to be an accommodating question that goes along with it at the bottom. That calls for something we use as participation. Great. We're not all going to sit here like bumps on a log for the next 3 hours. All right. So when that question comes up, that means that you guys are to engage in the training. All right. If at any point while I'm going on for the next 3 hours, you have questions, what do you think you do? Raise your hand. Cool. All right. Awesome. Raise your paddle, whatever it is. Okay. So I want to just review essentially what it is that we're going to accomplish in these next couple hours. All right. So we're going to go over what is Smarter. It was dead silent when I asked what it was in the beginning. So hopefully at the end, when I ask it again, we have a little bit more idea of what it is that we're talking about. Okay. What does it mean to me? So what is the purpose of attending any training, regardless of what the topic is? What's the point of it?
Learning.
Learning, okay? And what do you do with that learned information? Okay. How many of you, by show of hands, have sat in a training before and at the end of it felt like I got absolutely nothing out of that? That was a waste of my time. Cool. So your challenge during this, it shouldn't be a challenge, but my challenge to you is that as we're going through this, you have to find out what this methodology means to you, because there is not one way to do this job. Okay, there are what, 30-something people in this room right now? That means there are 30-something different ways to do this job. The way that I go in and interact with a rep might be different than the way, let's say, Verlin or Marlin or anybody that goes in there and talks to them. Your approach might be different. Why? Because we have different what?
Personalities.
All right, so what we don't want you to go in there and be like, oh, hi, this is like my 65th visit for the week, and I just want to get this over with. If you could give me some info, here's some free pens. Awesome, never come in my store again. That was terrible. All right, so you have to find out what it means to you, because when you do that, you identify the value. What is value? That's a tough question. What is value? Yeah, take a shot.
Something that means significance to you personally?
Yes, exactly. Okay, can you repeat it one more time louder for everybody?
Something that means
Something that is significant to you personally.
Yes, okay? That's what you have to find in all this, is how is this going to have significance to me so that I can be successful in my role? All right, because if you sit here at the end and you're like, okay, well, that really doesn't mean anything to me, you need to go back and reevaluate, because I guarantee, even if you're in here, does anybody in here think that they are like the greatest thing since sliced bread and they already know how to do this job? Come on, there's always one. Anybody? Cool, we have one in the back, awesome. With that, I can still promise you, what's your name?
Jim.
Jim, I can still promise you that you will most likely learn something from this that will make you better at your job. Everybody has something to learn. Even though I've done this training probably 60 times at this point, I always get new perspective from you guys that are coming in, all right, that challenge me to be better. So even though I facilitate this, I'm learning something every day, all right? How will I know if I'm doing it? This is a call to action, right? Incorporating this methodology, you have to actually use it. So what does it look like when I'm doing it? How will I know when I'm in the stores if I'm actually being smarter? Am I starting with a plan? Am I following the appropriate steps? Question?
You see results.
I'm sorry?
You see results.
When you see results. Yeah, absolutely. When you see those
positive
sales
results.
Rise.
Positive
results. Yes, if it's negative, we might want to reevaluate what we're doing, right? Okay, yeah, if you see those sales rise, or you see that somebody wants to be an advocate for a brand that maybe wanted to be a competitor's advocate before, and that's solely based off of the relationship that you've built, that's how you know that you're doing it right. Yes?
We have to measure your results while you're doing it.
Yeah. The hardest thing sometimes to do, especially when you're training, which is a lot of what we're doing in the stores, is to measure that. Training is one of the most difficult things to measure. Why? Because we're not working necessarily off of direct numbers. You guys, however, have the luxury of seeing the numbers. In Best Buy, they provide you, and we provide you with information that literally allow you to see how impactful you are. Okay? And we need to use that to our advantage. And what's the value for you? So at the end of this, what I want you to do is, as we're going through each letter, okay, because SMARTER is an acronym, as we're going through each letter, I want you to think, where is my strength? Which one of these elements of the methodology is my strength? And where is my largest opportunity for improvement? All right, and I want you to write that down as you go. If you need to wait until the end to kind of see how all of them are cumulatively and then decide, I'm totally good with that. All right, but once you identify that area of opportunity, we're going to call you to action on it. All right, we're going to send or have you send your manager an email. We're going to say, based on what I've learned in SMARTER methodology, this is where I see my largest opportunity for improvement, and here's my plan of action to make sure that I address it within the first 3 weeks of being in the field. All right, then it's focused. Then you know you're already going into the field with a goal. Why are goals important? Oh, hello, come on, people. Do we have a pulse? Let's go. Yes.
Goals are important because it sets a place for you to shoot for.
Yeah, it's the light at the end of the tunnel, right? Okay, very good. All right, so what does smarter mean to me? Has anybody ever heard that saying, work smarter, not
harder?
Okay, who can tell me what that means? Yes, Tom.
Working smarter, not harder, generally comes down to planning things in such a way that you can efficiently get the same task done and kind of foreseeing problems that may occur. So when they do come up, you're already prepared for them.
Okay, yes, absolutely. Yvette.
Spending less time getting more done.
Yes, okay. Efficiency, that's the common thread that I heard between you two. Jim in the back.
Using all your tools that are available to you.
Yes. That is one of the biggest issues that I see is people, especially when you get out in the field, you sometimes feel like you're this lone ranger that's just out there. Like, I'm out there, I'm visiting my stores by myself, I'm just kind of out there going after it. And they come into a confrontation with an issue that they're having that's debilitating for them to be able to do their job. And what do? Sometimes they just say, well, you know what, it'll get better with time. Or, you know what, I'm sure if we have more tools in the future, I will make it better. All right, but it's nobody's responsibility to make it better other than who?
Yourself.
You, okay, absolutely. So you are the ones that are responsible for making sure that you work smarter, not harder. If you're like, oh my gosh, I work like 70 hours this week, and it's a 45-hour work week, where does the challenge lie? Where does the problem, for lack of a better term, lie? In us, okay, and you have to be able to say that. You have to be able to say, you know what, that was an awesome visit, I rocked it, or you have to be able to say, oh my God, that visit sucked, and I need to never do it like that again, I need to ask different questions, I need to not be a freak that goes and stands there quietly in the aisles and doesn't say anything to anybody and just polishes everything and then runs out of the store when they're done, okay? All right, so work smarter, not harder. So let's go through these one by one. Start with a plan. Who can give me an idea after going through your KPIs and your expectations and what you think this job entails? What do you think a plan would consist of?
A detailed collection of events that you want to have while you're out visiting your store.
Okay, very good. I heard something else over here.
Routine.
A routine. Yeah, routines are good. Those are important, absolutely. Anything else that you guys think might come into play?
Jacob. Knowing your market before you even get out there.
Yes, think of what your title is. What is your title?
Sell through market manager.
There we go. Okay, that was good. It was kind of like, blah, 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 blah. Okay. Market sell through manager. What is the key word in there? What is that last word?
Manager.
So you are managing what?
Your market.
So you are responsible for that. LG is literally rolling out the red carpet and saying, Jason, congratulations, you are completely in control of the success of this market. How awesome is that? One of the largest brands in the entire world is laying the responsibility of their image and their success in this room. That's pretty freaking cool. Don't you think we might want to have an idea of how the heck we're going to achieve that? Cool. We're all going to have a plan, right? Yes, yeah. Katie, we are. Wonderful. Thank you. Maximize relationships. What do you envision when you think of maximizing relationships within your stores or even on your team amongst each other? Yes?
Just reaching out and connecting, making sure that you are introducing yourself at first to the managers, learning about them, making sure you keep the communication with all the employees and managers and everyone in your own network on the Create team.
Absolutely. Very good. Yvette?
Building a rapport with your people in the store so that not only are they wanting to represent our brand, but give you competitive information.
Yes, right? That is the key. Very good. Insider information. Yes?
For me, it's not just like with the people that sell the stuff, because we're going to be putting out displays and stuff too, so you want to build that rapport, get to know the guys that work behind the scenes, like in the warehouses and distribution.
Project team.
Yeah, if you have influence with planograms and placement of our product, that's huge. And that comes solely based off of the relationships that you have in store. If you don't have those relationships, almost every other step in this just becomes completely obsolete. It's nearly impossible to 100% achieve all these other steps if you don't have really great relationships. We are almost paying you to go out and make friends. We are paying you to go in and say, hi, my name is so-and-so from LG. I'm so excited to be here and I have the coolest job on the entire planet to talk about electronics and get paid for it and give away free stuff. Awesome, okay? Accelerate sales. This is pretty straightforward. Now I can ask you what it means to accelerate sales, but you are gonna be like, accelerate sales, okay? What I want to know is how do you envision yourself doing this?
When you're out in the store, like if I'm working on a display or something and a customer comes and asks me about it, I'll talk to them. I put the remote in their hand, let them get a feel for it, you know, and also make sure you close the sale.
Mm-hmm.
And if the person, like Best Buy, even if the blue shirt isn't there with you, they already know that's the TV that they want. So until you can find that blue shirt, you're going to pull it down for them, so they're going on with it no matter what.
Yeah, you are responsible for the representation of the brand and giving them the knowledge, but most importantly, giving them the experience. Mm-hmm. Everybody wants an experience when they're buying something. If you give them that experience, they're more likely to purchase into our brand and our product. James.
Yes, making sure that whether it be a customer or even the associate, they know everything and anything about your TVs as well as your competitors' information so that if they have an issue with the sale, they can do a rebuttal for the customer.
Yeah. We need them to be able to talk about our brand and our product when we're not in the store, right? And whose responsibility is it to make sure that those reps can speak to our product?
Ours.
Yeah, absolutely.
Use your incentives that you're given for the employees so that they sell, so that they get excited about LG, they know about it, and they want to sell your products for incentives.
Yeah, how much money do you guys have to spend every single month? $175 to help these people want to sell our product. Everybody wants something free. There was literally a cow on the back table that was here during lunch and everybody wanted it. Why? Who knows it's free? It's a five-finger discount. Everybody loves that. Who doesn't want that? Okay? F-R-E-E. Exactly. You think about that. I remember going into the stores myself as a product specialist, and the things I could get people to do for me for a pen was mind-blowing. Mind-blowing. I'd be like, can you sell 46 phones? I'd be like, yeah, can I have a pen? Sweet. Absolutely. You most certainly can. All right? It's the same thing when you guys go into the store. Yes, money motivates people, but when we go through this, there's a heck of a lot of other things that are motivational for people. Don't always use that $175 to drive your sales. Why? Because what if one day LG says, you know what? We don't have that budget anymore. We need you to actually go in and just sell based off of you and your relationships. You have to make sure that that's there at ground level, right? Okay. Research and capture data. On this one, I want some new volunteers who I haven't heard from yet. What does researching and capturing data look like to you on a store visit? Amberlee.
On a store visit, I will be checking in with my manager, what my point of contact is, to see what their numbers are, even if I get that data, just because I want to know if they know it.
Mm-hmm.
And I also want to see what their previous sales have been, like track back to a year and see if I can refurbish that.
Absolutely. Very good. Knowing your market, right? You're that market manager. Using that information that you have as a tool to work with your managers and also to help our brand. Tino.
I think it's very important to research competitors as well.
I'm so glad that you said that. Has anybody heard that saying of keep your friends close, but who closer?
Enemies.
Okay? For lack of a better term, our competitors are our enemies. They threaten our ability to be the number one brand in the world. And the better that we know them and what we're up against, the better we can position ourselves and call out how we trump them. Because I can guarantee you almost every single time that we do. It's just sometimes the reps aren't educated, and that's where we have to come in. You have to take the time to educate yourself on the competitors. Absolutely. Very good. Train with purpose and impact. Oh, I didn't even ask for a volunteer, and already we have hands raised. Yes.
I like to get to know my reps and what they like so I can gear my training towards them, so I'm not just like Charlie Brown teaching want, and then tune it out.
Yeah.
And I also make sure that when I train them, I'm training them as about how I want them to talk to customers, so they're not future dumping on people. Explain to them the benefits, and then if they're more technical.
Yes, this is amazing. Can you just come up here and do the rest of the training for me? Because you literally just talked about so many things that we're going to address. And that's awesome. Features versus benefits. Feature dumping. Literally going in there and verbally vomiting all over people. And then they don't remember anything. They just remember that you came in, said a lot of stuff, gave them some free things, and then walked out. All right? We need to have more of a residual effect. Absolutely. We need to make sure that what we're doing is actually impactful. Before I call on you, one second. Who in here can give me an example of a training that they've been to before that they felt was most impactful in their lives and why? Has anybody been to a training where you actually felt like it was impactful? Anybody that's been to an LG training before should be raising your hand right now, because I was probably there. So perfect, Landell. Thank you so much for volunteering. Anybody else? Yes, Yvette.
The Google training.
Why was that impactful?
I just like their overall view on the relationship. It's really built on relationship and not making customers feel like you're trying to sell them something, like you said, verbally vomiting features on them. But, you know, relationship building.
Mm-hmm.
And that I use that in any walk of life. So you can, in anything I do, because you're building a relationship. You're finding out what that customer's needs are, and then you can take that information that you get from the conversation and build it back into how does my product benefit you?
Mm-hmm.
You specifically, not you, everybody.
Not a generalized, right? There are different reasons that people buy the same product. All right, there are at least within LG, within the market segment, we've identified at least 9 different customer segments. But by the time you take all those, combine them together, and multiply them by the 90 billion different possibilities that there could be, Think about the different types of customers that you've come into contact with. And if you just feature dump and just give a generalized training to them, it's not going to mean anything. People purchase emotionally, right? To a certain extent. A family member recommended it. That's emotional. Why? Because they trust that person. They're spending $600 on it. Why is that emotional? Because they earn that hard money and they want to make sure that they're spending it on the right thing. Why? Because they might not be able to upgrade every 3 months, and they might not be able to buy a new TV every year or 2 years or whatever it is. Absolutely. Very good. In the back, I miss you. What's your name? Sebastian.
This is Sebastian.
Sebastian. You had your hand raised before.
I was just kind of building off of what Amber Lee said.
Yeah.
Building that relationship with the associates and then also teaching them to use sales style. Doing a needs analysis with the customer,
mm-hmm.
really seeing what they're looking for, what they do on their, you know, with their lives. Are they watching sports? Are they playing video games? What would be the best product for them, and put them in the right product?
Mm-hmm.
If you don't put them in the right product first, they're going to be mad at you, they're going to be mad at the brand, and that's going to be not customer satisfaction right there, and they may not recommend your brand next time.
Absolutely. And that's one of the most detrimental things that can happen to us. If we don't just kind of right fit them in the very beginning and we get them into something else, if it results in a return, that not only hurts your relationship potentially with that customer, but also with that rep. Because they're the ones that are feeling most times the implications of that return in their pockets. All right? Very good. Elevate brand loyalty. Who can give me an example of how you envision yourself elevating LG brand loyalty in your stores once you get out there? Are you going to go in there and be like, oh, hey, yeah, LG's like the coolest, dude. Sweet. No? That's not going to get people excited about the brand, is it? No? And you're not giving them any reason, all right? Who wants to give me an example? You guys have been awesome. I'm going to call in the back.
I've always done it with my energy levels, showing that personally I believe that this is the best product out there, not going in just dumping a speech, but going and kind of representing myself as opposed to a product.
Yeah.
Like, this is what I love, this is what I know, and I want to share that with you as opposed to just giving the product. Right?
Yeah, it's kind of seeing is believing for people. If you come in and you hardly have a pulse and you're trying to get them excited about your brand, what do you think the chances are that they're going to be like, oh man, I can't wait to buy LG? Never. But if you go in and you're like, yes, I love this. This is a great TV. This is a great soundbar. This is whatever it may be. And this is why. And this is my personal experience. You're much more likely to get their buy-in. Spot on. Who else had a hand raised? Tom.
For me, I think, let's say I'm going to be going into a Best Buy.
Okay.
I'd like to get very familiar with the layout of that particular Best Buy.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm in there and I see, you know, the guys in, let's say, the TV video section are really busy, and a customer has a simple question, I know exactly where to take them. I can walk the customer there. Even if they're buying just a simple HDMI cable, they're going to see my LG shirt. They're going to see that I'm not a Best Buy employee. Plus, the Best Buy guys are going to see that. So when it comes down to actually when they have a moment and we can talk about the new soundbar or the 4K TV, they're going to care a little bit more because they know that Tom cares enough to know exactly where everything in our Best Buy is.
Mm-hmm.
It helps customers that are not related to him in any way. And I can help him out by, you know, talking about LG and selling more LG for him.
Yeah, and that comes back to where, right? We talked about how this is all interconnected. That comes back to your relationships, absolutely. And you couldn't be more right that you're walking into these stores with an LG shirt on. You are the LG brand. If anybody asks you who you work for, you say, LG. So if a customer comes up to you, you are literally a representation of the brand to that person. How you present yourself, how you present the product, how much passion you put behind it, is their implication of what type of brand we are. Okay? What is our slogan for our brand?
Life's good.
Life's good. So when we go into stores, do we want people to be like, I don't know, life could kind of suck. These people are not excited. No. We want them to be like, oh my gosh, life is really good. And I'm telling you, when you tell people that you work for LG, you will literally want to poke your eyes out at how many people are just like, oh, life's good, dude, yeah, all right? But at the end of the day, you literally have to act like it's the first time you've ever heard it, because you know what? It is amazing. We have the best product on the market. You have one of the coolest jobs that has ever existed. There is no reason for life not to be good. Life should be great when we're going into there, all right? We need to elevate that brand loyalty. We need those people to feel that same passion. Get them excited about our brand. Yvette, did you have a comment?
Well, I just wanted to add to what he said. There will be people who are in these stores who, just because they like you, they will be loyal to your product. I mean, I had people sell Google stuff who never did it before, mm-hmm. but after I came in and built relationships and had that rapport, they were like, okay, I'm going to do this for you.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, we are the walking, breathing representative of the brand.
Mm-hmm.
So how you bring yourself to work every day
mm-hmm.
is what people see. We're very visual people.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're sucking, that's what the product is that day.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's their perception of what the brand is. Absolutely. And we've seen that on our team as well. I hear it all the time. I'll go on to market visits and I'll talk to some of the managers and the reps that are in the store and they'll be like, you know what? I really like the LG product. We've kind of waxed and waned a little bit. I'm excited for your new stuff that's coming out. I have a lot of people coming in and asking for competitor brands, but I continue to sell your brand because I like your rep. They come in, they always have something to offer, they're always bringing in value, they always have knowledge, they're always challenging me, they have an interest in me personally, and they always make the time for me. And because of that, I'm gonna sell on behalf of them. I'm gonna sell their brand specifically because I hear that all the time. So you're spot on with that, very good. Reflect and report. Now, when we think of reflect, I don't mean you have to go out into your car and sit there like the thinker and be like, how amazing was this visit? Well, if you're anybody, you're gonna be like, oh my gosh, that was the greatest visit I've ever done. But at the same point, you have to be honest with yourself and say, what worked and what didn't work? All right, because you're going to make mistakes. There's a saying that says kind of fail your way to success. We don't want you to fully fail, but we do want you to make some mistakes and learn from them, because that's the only way that you can get better. All right, maybe you have this idea of how you're gonna go out and you're gonna execute your visits. You go in there, you try it out, and because there's some different personalities in the store that maybe you anticipated, you have to adjust your approach. So you have to be honest with yourself and say, you know what, that didn't go as great, but I know where I went wrong and I know what I'm gonna do differently next time. And then when you go into the store next time, make sure that you do that, okay? Reporting. How important is reporting in the grand scheme of our role?
Same day.
Oh my gosh, same day. It's very important. It is like the sun is shining down. Everybody's like, oh, yes. Literally, LG would not get any information about their product if we don't report it. There are not secret little LG elves out there in the middle of the night finding out answers to questions to fill in the blanks where you guys missed. No. If you don't get it and you don't ask the questions and you don't do the research and you don't do the legwork in the store visits, LG has no way of knowing what's going on with their brand and their product unless we tell them. So the biggest mistake that I see people make is they go in and they have these awesome, amazing store visits that are mind-blowing, and then they go home and they fill in their reports and they're like, I trained and cleaned on TVs. Really? That's what you're gonna tell LG that you did in the store today? That's the value that you wanna present to them? You had this amazing store visit and you're not doing yourself any service by not putting the effort into the reporting. The reporting is the reflection of every amazing thing that you do in the store. All right? You have to do it same day. What are some of the reasons that we do same day reporting?
It's fresh.
It's on time. They're getting it sooner. Yeah, you're not forgetting anything. It's literally from mouth into the report. Awesome. That's exactly what we want. All right, so we can go through and we can do all of these things. But if at the end of the day, we don't report on it, like Rich said, you might as well have just gone out and played a round of golf. Because if you don't provide any sort of research or data to the client, what was the point of going into the store?
There wasn't a point.
We've lost our value at that point, right? And that's an issue, all right? So we gotta make sure that we're taking all these amazing things that we're doing and sharing them with the client. That validates why they continue to ask us to go into the store and represent their brand, okay? All right, so let's dig into these a little bit deeper. So, when LG first started out years ago, I believe we had a total of about 9 reps in the field. Across all 3 accounts, at this point, I've lost count of how many people we have. Rich, how many do we have between HE and HA?
Close to 200.
And then on the mobile team, we have probably close to about 300, 350. Okay? Everybody add that up. What is that? 550 people. We have gone from 13 people to 550 people in less than 10 years. That's incredible. All right? But when we started, what we did was drastically different than what we do today. We were considered a messenger. How many of you guys have seen like a bike messenger before? They're on their bikes, they're in New York, they're like pedaling around. What is it that they're doing? They're delivering a message. It's literally as simple as that, right? They're taking a message from point A to where?
Point B.
Point B. And then what responsibility do they have after that?
None.
They've done their job. They literally just point A to point B and they're done. So as a messenger, when we were first going into the stores, it was just kind of like, I'm just going to show up. I'm going to maybe talk about some stuff. I'm going to leave my business cards, a few pens. I don't know. I'll like come back in a couple months and see how things are going. It was very different than how we do things today. But we reported on it. Okay? And then what type of value do you think took us from being a messenger to now being a consultant for the LG brand? In the reporting, what do you think that they were getting?
Results.
Information that we were bringing, positive results. Yeah, we're going in, we're influencing sales. Like Alan Hall said, we're evangelizing a product. We're making them aware of it. What does a consultant do? And please don't say consult. What does a consultant do? Yes, Jepson.
Give advice.
They give advice. Okay, what else? Tom.
They find maybe a weakness or something that needs to be worked on. Plan on it, we'll make a game plan and stick with you from beginning to end to make sure that plan comes to fruition.
They identify a challenge or a problem and then they offer the solution. Very good. Sebastian.
It's an extension of their sales team, so it's an additional help on the sales floor, I guess.
Okay, additional help and insight into the sales team. Absolutely.
Kind of direct the motive. Direct what's going on. The consultant gives advice.
Mm-hmm.
But to really push them in a direction to get where they need to go.
Yes. Okay, very good. Right down.
Collect strategic data.
They do what?
Collect strategic data.
Collect strategic data. Yes. So all of these things, guess what? Those are all things that who does now?
We do.
We are literally the consultants for the LG brand. If they say, you know what, they're finding out in your reports, something isn't working. Okay, we're telling them, you know what, the way that we're positioning this or the price point or our competitors are doing this and we need to do something differently. That's great if we come to them with the issue. What else do you think LG is going to be looking for that we said a consultant does?
A solution, a plan.
It's like that saying, don't just come to me with the problem, come to me with a solution. Okay, so if you find that something is not working in your stores, don't just go into your report and be like, XYZ isn't working, this TV isn't selling because, well, I don't know, they just said so. This TV is not selling because of where it's positioned in the planogram and the price point of $1,500 as opposed to Samsung's $1,200 that has this huge display in the front of the store, and then take pictures. All right, we have this fun little saying on our account that pictures translate better into Korean. Haha. Okay. It allows them to see what's going on in the store. It allows them a little belated response on that. Who was it? Was it J. Anthony? Nice. Okay, very good. He was like, oh, that just clicked. okay, so when we're consultants, now this is our mindset going into the stores. Before it was just like, what can I talk about today? Let's just talk about the brand, rah, rah, that sounds like fun. Now when we go in, we say, how can I show the retail sales associates how this information helps them meet their sales goal? If we go in and the RSAs recognize that, yes, we're in there to help ourselves a little bit, right? We need to get some LG information, we need to collect some data. But if you have a rep that comes into your store and you feel like their main interest is you as a retail sales associate, what does that do for them, do you think? And what do you think it does for us on our end? What's the advantage?
It empowers them.
It empowers them. And what do we hope that empowerment leads to?
Sales.
All right? Absolutely. If we go in there and our number one goal is to help them out, help me help you. They are going to be more likely to what Yvette said based on those relationships. Man, this person keeps coming in here and helping me and they don't even have to. I'm going to help them out. Okay? And that's what we need to do. Every time we go in there, we need to make sure that these RSAs recognize and feel the value of us coming in there. All right? Now, sometimes is it going to be like Groundhog Day where you go in and you feel like you're talking about the same things over and over again? Sure, we have a message that we have to deliver. But through the passion that we talked about incorporating, the enthusiasm, the excitement for the brand, it's also our responsibility to say, you know what? I know this product better than anybody else, right? That's our job. I know this product better than everybody else, that every time I go into that store, I'm going to have something new to talk about. Every single time. Why do you think that that's important?
Keeps it fresh.
Keeps it fresh. Very good. What else?
Makes you seem more knowledgeable.
Makes them recognize that you are, in fact, more knowledgeable.
Keep them more interested in you.
Keep them more interested. How many of you guys have been into a situation where maybe a manufacturer rep or somebody has just come in and they're telling you the same story, they're telling you the same things that they told you last time they were in the store? What do you do when they do that?
Turn around.
Zone out. Turn around, zone out, not pay attention. Do we want to be those people that they zone out on?
No.
So if you see that glazed look starting to come over in their eyes and they just start asking about free stuff, that means you're not doing your job. That means that you're coming in there and you're talking about the same things over and over again. That means they're bored. It's our job to keep it exciting and interesting. We have so much to talk about with our products and with our brand and what our competitors are doing that it should never be the same. Can we follow up on information? Absolutely. Should we? Every time, of course. But at the same point, we should always bring something new. Always. Keeps it interesting. Okay. So within our plan, there's always logistics. Why? Keep track. Yes, okay. I hear little murmurs out there. So we want to maximize the budgets that we have. We want to maximize that $175. How can we get the most out of that every single month? Do we just want to say, hey, you know what? If you like look at an LG TV this month, I'll give you guys a pizza party. No. Who can give me an example of what a better challenge would be to maximize that budget?
Set targets and goals weekly.
Set weekly targets and goals. What else?
Contest while I'm in the store today. I'm in the store today. Whoever
sells
the first TV while I'm here gets a
gift
prize.
Card. Boom! Yes! Do an in-store contest while you were there. Why? It helps you to manage it. Number two, it actually helps to keep them accountable. Number three, you can take an amazing picture with that customer and with that rep and send that to our client. What else? I saw a couple other hands raised. Yes?
Maybe setting up, like, if you walk into a store that you don't visit as frequently mm-hmm. as some of the other high-volume stores. You do a training with a couple of the consultants and say, hey, pay forward. Talk to the other guys in your team, and when I come in next time, the first person I talk to, they mention what I trained you on today. You get $5, and he gets $5, or she gets $5 for Starbucks or something.
I love that. Yes, and I love that. And why is that so valuable? Did everybody hear what he said?
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay, so why is that so valuable? What is he implementing there? Yes.
You're creating mind share.
Yes.
Between everyone that's there. So now, and it's exponential. It's you're replicating yourself when you're not even there.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you're replicating yourself when you are not even there. People are selling the brand when you are not even there. You're creating mindshare of people talking about our brand well after you've left. It also requires them to retain the information that you train them on and then do what?
Share it.
If they can actually regurgitate the information you shared, that means they've actually done what with it?
Learned it.
Okay, because they can say, to your face the whole time as you're feature dumping all over them, and then they leave and they're like, I actually have no idea how to demonstrate that feature. If you get them to do it back or do it back with another one of their employees, golden. That is like you open up the package and there's a golden ticket right there. That's amazing. Yes?
I was going to say you can reward for retaining information. Like if you go to a store train and come back the next time and rep, hey, I used what you taught me last time and it sold me X amount of TVs.
Mm-hmm.
Reward them for that, for using what you're training them.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All of these things that you're doing, every time you teach them something new or you give them a new piece of information, do a call to action with them. What is a call to action? Yes, it is something that you do. You're act upon. Very good. Asking them to produce for you. Hey, I trained you on this feature. But the next time I come in, if you were able to incorporate that into your sales and it led to something positive, share that with me and I'll reward you for it. Challenge them to use the information. Yes?
Also, to add to that, they just leave a recognition and wherever they're not
knowledgeable and you just train them on that at that point.
Yeah.
Make sure they do understand.
Absolutely. You know what? A success is not always, is it great when it's monetary and it turns into sales for us? Absolutely. But there are also challenges that you can put into place to help maximize your relationships as well. If you see somebody is not as knowledgeable about our product, invest in them. Okay? Absolutely.
I've seen this happen before, and this helped out with sales doing in-store events. Not only are you training and educating the associates, but you're also training, educating, and selling to your customers. They're experiencing what it's like to work in that store while they're learning about the product at the same time.
Oh, absolutely. Phenomenal. Yes.
A lot of times, too, if you don't train a rep on a new product, and they don't feel comfortable selling it, they won't. They'll just default to what they do know how to sell.
Exactly, exactly. They'll train on what they have at home, or they'll train on what somebody has seated with them, or whatever it may be. We see this in mobile all the time. It's like, hey, yeah, you know what, the Samsung rep came in and they gave us this free phone, so that's just what we sell. Because I know it, because I use it all the time. That's where our challenge does come in. Absolutely, they will default to what they feel most comfortable with. So that's where the challenge lies for us. To show our proficiency in our role, to train them so that they feel just as comfortable, if not more comfortable, talking about and presenting our product when we're not there. Very good.
Some of the employees, especially with Best Buy, sometimes they just feel like they're just another employee. But when you give them that special recognition, you know, that hey, you did learn what I taught you, and look what you did. You got 5 sales this week from it.
Yeah.
That special recognition helps them out a lot.
So. Absolutely. Makes them feel like a bigger fish in a big pond, right? Absolutely. Very good. Okay. So we talked about before, actually, Barb, I think, was talking about it when we were discussing efficiency and how you plan out where you're going to actually visit for the week. All right? So do you think we drive over here and then maybe down to the far left and then up here and all over creation? No. Why not? It's a waste of your time.
And money.
Whose money? LG's money. I can think of a heck of a lot of other ways that I would rather see them invest their money than putting it into our gas tanks. More promotional money, bonuses, whatever it may be. All right? So we need to take a look at where your locations are. All right? So everybody will know what your locations are when you log into PD. Great. That's your market. Now, when you actually map them out using a tool that's called, does anybody remember what Barb said it was called? Maps and Batch and Google and Streets and Trips. There it is. Cool. Streets and Trips. Streets and Trips is an efficiency tool for us. It allows us to actually put all of our stores into a map, see where they are, and then choose the most efficient route. It's less windshield time for you, more time in the stores, and allows you to get through your visits so that you can do your reporting same day. And you're not sacrificing quality in any way, shape, or form. Okay? So we need to look at our locations. We also need to take into account the frequency with which we're visiting these locations. Know how many times you're supposed to visit higher tiered locations versus lower tiered locations so that you're not wasting your time saying, shoot, I went to the store and I actually wasn't even supposed to come back for another 2 weeks or whatever it was. Or, oh, our focus this week is only Best Buy and I accidentally showed up to a Costco. Don't waste your time. All right? At the end of the day, that's what's important, right? Because when you are done, at the end of the day, what do you want to do?
Go home,
play video games, take your dog for a walk, play with your kids. What?
Report,
yes, exactly, report. I was going to say just go home and do whatever you want to do, but yes, we do also want to make sure that we report, okay? Very good. We need to take time and traffic into account. Nobody knows their markets better than you guys do. And everybody knows when you do and don't get on the beltways and when you do and don't get on the highways. Take those things into account. You have the ability and the beauty of creating your own schedule to a certain extent. If you know that if you leave at 8:00 in the morning, you're going to be sitting in traffic for 2 hours and you're not going to get there until 10:00 anyways, or if you just left at 9:30 and could get there at 10:00, stay home, plan out your entire day, and then just leave at 9:30, get there at 10:00. It's less windshield time for you, and it's less of a waste of resources. Okay? Make sure that you're taking these things into account. Now, that doesn't mean that you can be like, well, there was a lot of traffic, so I didn't make it to my store visits today. Well, that doesn't really count. Okay? Mileage allowance. Keep this honest. We do use Streets and Trips to audit and make sure that we are taking the most efficient routes. so that we're not wasting the money and the resources of our client, but also so you're not wasting your time. And you can spend more time in store cultivating those what? Relationships. Okay, good. Planning tools, like we talked about. You have your PD calendar. Have we talked about yet how far in advance we plan out our PD calendar?
A month.
Cool. So are we planning out like 3 hours before we go into the store?
No.
No. Okay. So use your PD calendar. It's not a guessing game as to where you're going. Location applications, if you want to use those. So we use check-in, check-out, right? That shows us where you are, how long you're spending time in the store. A lot of people say check-in, check-out. That seems kind of like Big Brother. There's actually advantages to us in the field for using check-in, check-out. So when the client comes to us and they say, well, you know what? We think it would be better if you spent 5 hours in one store. And so we go in, we spend 5 hours, and we do the reporting. If we're using check-in and check-out, we can track how long you're spending in the store and the quality of report and information that you're getting against that. So we can go to the client and say, you know, we spent 90 minutes in a store and we spent 5 hours and we got just as much information and had just as large of an impact. Or it could be vice versa and say, you know what? We do need to spend a little bit longer in these locations. So it's beneficial for us and for the client to manage their expectations and have realistic expectations of what we can and cannot achieve in the field. So check-in, check-out is an enormously helpful tool for us and for you. All right, and then streets and trips. The number one rule with streets and trips is use it. The number one rule with streets and trips is?
Use it.
Use it, okay? Every time one of your managers comes to your market to do a ride-along, guess what they're gonna be asking for? Streets and trips, they're gonna wanna see, hey, where are we going today? Cool, print that out, I'd love to see that. We wanna make sure that you are maximizing your time and being as efficient as possible. Now, this is a very important point, all right? Who wants to read that out loud for me? Tom, awesome.
The stores you visit dictate the messages you will deliver.
Who wants to take a guess at what this means? Amberlee.
Relate to your client.
Yes, okay. So maybe parts of your market have different customers or consumers, and so you need to train appropriately, right? What else?
Most impact, like high-volume stores.
High-volume stores, yes, absolutely. Steven?
Basically, if you go into a store that doesn't have one TV on display that the other does, you don't want to go in there expecting to see that TV and it's not there.
Yeah, or not knowing that it's... not knowing that it's not there and training on it, and they're like, we actually don't even have that in stock. Okay, yeah, absolutely. Tom?
Working on the weaknesses of each individual store, so each one should have its own plan. It can't be, you know, all Best Buy's all
Yes, absolutely. Very good. Identify the challenges that those stores are having, and with the value that you have, do what you can to help them overcome those challenges. Very good. J. Anthony.
Know the area. What I say by that is, if I'm in the Galleria area, it would be okay for me to focus on 4K Ultra HD. Mm. But if I'm in, like, for those of you who've been to Houston, but if I'm in like Gulfgate or Pasadena area, where that's not such a big thing, it doesn't make any sense for me to go in there and train. Or if I'm in Costco where they don't carry it, it doesn't make sense for me to go in there and train.
Yeah, exactly, and that comes in with your plan, is knowing your locations. Your plan is going to change slightly depending on the stores that you're going to. Mm-hmm. Best Buy's are different than Costco's and H.H. Gregg's and Fry's and all of those. All of them operate differently. There's different expectations of the employees. The inventory is different, absolutely. And their customer bases are different. You have to cater to that, all right? I saw another hand somewhere else. Anyway, yes, James.
Well, if you're gonna be in the store, make your message
heard. Yes.
Nothing being said.
Yeah, or we don't know what their message is. We don't know how they're representing our brand when we're not there. Absolutely, very good. Okay, so with our messaging, make sure that your equipment is charged. Okay, we're all using G-pads, right? Cool, so if you go in there and you go to start filling out your reports or looking up some information that your manager sent you and it's dead, and now you don't have access to that information, what are you gonna do? Go out into your car, fire up your laptop, waste a little bit more time? We don't want to do that, okay? So make sure that your G2s to take photos are charged and ready to go. Make sure that any equipment that you need for your visits to be successful is prepared, okay? appropriate for the location. Exactly like what Anthony just talked about, where he said, well, you know, if I go into a store, they may not even have the product that I'm supposed to be focusing on or that we're addressing, so I need to make sure that I change my messaging. Or sometimes they'll do promotions in some store locations and not others. Maybe Best Buy is running a promotion and Fry's isn't. Don't go into Fry's and start talking about this great promotion that LG is doing on home electronics, and then all of a sudden they're like, yeah, that's not actually us. That's Best Buy that's doing it.
Yeah.
What have you just done in that instance?
Killed your sales,
your credibility, yeah, your relationship, all right? How much longer do you think it takes to overcome a challenge like that? A very long time. Credibility is everything, especially when you tell somebody that they're going to make more money and then you just rip the rug out from underneath them. Oh, psych, April Fools, it's September, whatever, all right? So make sure that you know exactly what it is that you're talking about. Has the right software. There's software updates that come through all the time for our equipment. If something's not performing appropriately the way that it should, when you're in the stores, who is responsible for making sure that that gets taken care of? The reps in the store? Well, yeah, that'd be cool if they took care of it, but do they have the time?
No.
No, because they're busy trying to do what?
Sell.
Make money and sell. So it's our responsibility to make sure that these updates are pushed through, that signage is updated, that pricing is correct, that our call-out cards are reflecting appropriately what it is that we want them to say, and what's within the planogram. And we have access to that information. It's your responsibility to make sure that all that stuff is in place. Because this goes back to what is their interpretation of the brand. For a lot of customers, sometimes if you're not there or a rep is not around, when they walk up to a TV, okay, let's say they walk up to this TV, maybe it's not on, and it's got little fingerprints all over it, and the controller is like on the floor with the batteries out, and they see the LG brand on that. What, as a consumer, and then next to that is a Samsung TV. It's got this great demo going on. It's got the remote control right there for them to mess around with. It's clean and shiny. As a consumer, which one do you think you would gravitate towards?
Samsung.
The Samsung. Which one do we want them to gravitate towards?
LG.
So whose responsible is it to make sure that it's the one that's updated with all the videos and it's clean and shiny?
Market sell-through manager.
Market sell-through manager. Us, okay? Because again, that is a representation of our brand. How our product looks? If it looks like junk, people are going to think it's junk. We have to make it look gorgeous, beautiful, all the time. We want people to come in. Do you everybody ever like walk into those big stores and you just walk back to the TV department and everybody's like this? They're not going to do that at a blank TV. I mean, they may, but well, yes, in Walmart. You never know. But that's what we want customers to do. We want them to stand in front of the LG TVs and be like, I need that. How much is that? Do you have 0% financing? Yes. Okay? That's what we need. We need that to happen. Okay? Demo scripts. If you have specific demos on products that you're supposed to be doing, and there's a script that goes along with it, do you think it's important that we know it? Yes. Now, do you think that we come up with these scripts just to be like, well, let's see how many of you can actually remember this? No, that is no fun for us to sit around and come up with that. What is the point of these demo scripts?
So you do the bullet points and highlights of what you need to talk about.
So you get the bullet points and the highlights of what you need to talk about, yes. What else?
So that everybody's on the same page.
Yes, so that everybody's on the same page. So that we are giving a consistent message. Our brand is consistently being represented in the exact same way. It's kind of like why schools wear uniforms. Cool, it takes a questioning about it. We are all representing in the exact same way. Okay? Hot sheets. Have we talked about hot sheets in PD at all? Yeah, a little bit? A little bit? Does anybody remember what hot sheets are? Maybe? Yeah, if there's any updates in messaging or if there's any information that you can take in the store, that's going to be quick access to it. Make sure you're checking your hot sheets every single day for any updates. Yeah, promotions, promotional updates, reminders, whatever it is, make sure you're checking those hot sheets. And then messaging priorities. This goes into your demo scripts. Your messaging priorities could literally change on a dime. How do you think that they decipher whether or not they're going to change your messaging priorities? Reports. Who said reports?
Reports.
Yes, 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 yes. If you put it in your reports and they're consistently seeing feedback from us that says, hey, we're going out, we're messaging, or we're delivering this message, and it's not working, okay, we need to change that, right? We need to change that right away. So we might change our messaging priorities overnight, all right? Very good. Organize your promotional materials. What is it that Lance calls kind of our little goodies game?
Trinkets and trash.
I you know what? I do too, but it's kind of, he kind of has a point, all right? It is literally stuff that now that you guys are going to have 60,000 pieces of it and it's going to be taking over your secondary home that you're going to have to purchase a house, all of it, you're going to probably feel like it is. But the weight that it carries and the ability that we have to incentivize it, make sure that it works for you. The number one mistake, and I see so many people make this, the number one mistake that everybody could make is you get all this free stuff and you go in and you're like, hey, I'm the new LG rep. Here's all this free stuff. Do you like me yet? Cool. Next time you come in, you're going to be like, hey, so I want to ask you something. Do you have any free stuff for us this week? Do you think that they're even going to remotely care what it is that you have to say? It's like going in and literally just giving it all away up front. And they didn't even have to do anything for it. My best practice is your first, and Rich can call me out on this if he disagrees, but I would say probably your first 2 to 3 visits that you're going into a store, unless there is a specific promotional incentive that requires otherwise, the first couple times that you're going in there, don't bring anything with you. Don't bring anything with you. Because the only thing of value that they should be getting from that visit is building a relationship with you, getting information from you, learning from you, being trained by you. What are they giving you in return?
Attention.
Attention. Okay. So then maybe the third time you come back, say, you know what? It's been awesome getting to know you. You guys have given me some really good information over the last couple weeks. Now here's a little something. Let them know that they have to earn it. If you just give it away for free, that's going to be the expectation. Exactly. It's like, why buy the cow? Yes. Or does anybody go into the movie theater and just go in and watch the end of the movie and then walk out? Because they don't care what happens in between the beginning and the end. No.
It's a Marvel movie.
Okay. Well, I'm sure there's some instances. But for the most part, nobody goes into the movie theater just to watch the end of the movie. It's just over with. And then there's no understanding of how it is that you got there. And that understanding has to be, I need to have a relationship with you. I need to be invested in the training that you're giving. I see that you bring value. And you know what? I actually kind of like talking to you every once in a while that you come in here. The way that you know that you're losing is you go in, you give it all away, and then you come in and they see you and they turn around and they go like this. That's not what we want, all right? So make sure that you have all that stuff. Seating devices, I don't know how often we do seating, if ever, at all. But if anybody ever asks you, does anybody know what a seating program is? Okay. This one's my favorite because so many people will ask you this question. So when are you going to give me a free TV? Well, probably never. But thank you for asking. But here's what I can tell you. You can log on to ThinkLG. You can take some trainings about our product. You can get to know about it. You can get points for taking those trainings. And then 65 years from now, you'll actually have enough points to get a TV. And you can learn one of our products that way. All right? But still, it's getting them to go in, learn about a product, and we can reward them. And there are instances with that $175 budget that we can do just as many things to appease them in the meantime to keep them excited about our brand and the relationships that you have. All right? All right. Incentive materials. If you are doing incentives in your store, what do you think is the number one most important fact of doing incentives in your store? Following up, yes.
Making sure that they're excited about your product and that they know if they do this, then there's something that they can get.
Yeah, what if they're not excited about the incentive and you just created it on a whim because you thought it sounded fun? It was like Yvette sounded before. She said, well, you know, I kind of want to know what it is that motivates them so I can figure out how to incentivize them. What if I come in with a bunch of Starbucks gift cards and nobody drinks coffee? Yeah. Well, they're probably not going to want to do anything for it, right? Yes. Yes. Yes.
Make sure it's clear with the manager of the store.
Excellent.
Yes. Did everybody hear what he said?
No. Excellent.
Repeat.
Making sure that everything is clear with the manager first.
Yes.
That is the number one rule. Why is that so important? Sebastian.
I was say, number one, make it necessary. Number two, make it memorable. And mm-hmm. number three, make it trackable.
Agreed. I agree with all of those things. But all of those things have to come after you make sure it's okay with the manager. Because if you go in there and you're just like, no, I'm just going to create something, the manager has no idea that it's going on. Number one, they're not going to keep them accountable once you've left the store. And number two, what have you done at this point?
Overstep boundaries.
Yes. Here's the line. We just crossed it. And now there's no way to get back, right? Okay, Amberly.
I just wanted to add on to that. It's extremely important to make sure that it's okay with management. I worked for another company before. I'm not going to mention their name. But they would tell us to go out and just do stuff. And then the corporates from like AT&T, T-Mobile, Verizon, etc. would be like, no, you can't do this. So we'd have to go in. So I'd have to go in, tell my reps, sorry, this contest you've been working for, I can't give you the price for it. So it made my life very hard, and it made them not want to sell my product anymore.
Yeah, and it seriously jeopardizes your relationship. Okay? Yes.
Doesn't Best Buy have a policy about, like, that looks like bribery? You're not supposed to bribe the reps.
Yes.
So having a relationship and getting it clear and actually letting the manager get involved in the contest is a great way to do it. Just have the manager actually say, well, what would you like to see your reps do in terms of this promotion?
Mm-hmm.
And having them be involved, make sure that you don't cross any lines in terms of bribery and mm-hmm. them kind of sets the framework.
Yep. You establish a relationship with the manager, right? You establish credibility with them. You have respect with them. Nobody knows those employees better than their own manager, so you can make sure that it's relatable. That all this money and time that you're investing, they actually have an interest in selling your product to gain whatever that incentive is. Also, it's most likely that those employees are going to feel more accountable to their manager than they are to you. So if their manager is a part of it, they are more likely to actually drive that promotion when you're not even there. All right? Every single time. I'm sorry, go ahead.
They may have their own goals.
Yes.
And that way you can assist them in reaching their goals. So again, you're looking like you're helping the manager of the department reach their goals.
Absolutely. And that goes back to what we said earlier, right? Of coming in and finding out how we can help them meet their sales goals. If we can position our incentives around that, two birds with one stone. That's amazing. Help me help you. Okay? Very good. Very good. One of the great examples that I saw was when I was in the field and I was doing a ride along, and we had a product that had just launched and it wasn't selling in this one location. And our rep at the time said, I've tried creating incentives. I've tried doing gift cards. I've tried doing pizza parties. I've tried seating devices. And no matter what I do, this product just will not sell. And I said, well, have you spoken to the manager? And he's like, no, I actually never did that. I said, okay, well, when we go in, why don't we try that? And the manager said, yeah, I know you've been coming in here, and I don't mind that you've been doing incentives, but honestly, I think it's just been a waste of your time. And if you just come to me from the beginning, what I could have told you is you actually don't need to give my reps anything. I can tell you that there is one thing that I as a manager can give them that you will never be able to give them. And so we were like, okay, what's this? The gift of time. You can never give my people time. I can. You want a promotion? I'll tell you what this promotion and what this incentive is going to be. He said, whoever sells the most of this product within the next month will have the ability to make their own schedule however they want it for the next month. They can choose what days they want off. They can choose when they come in. They can choose when they leave. They can choose who it is that they work with. They have full control over their entire schedule, and it doesn't cost you a dime. That's what they want. They would rather have that than a $5 Starbucks gift card. They would rather have that than a pizza party. And it didn't cost us anything. You would never have known that if you didn't talk to the manager. All right? So make sure that you have those relationships. We've seen there's multiple reasons why you have to clear it with the manager. But look at that scenario. That's perfect. And it doesn't cost us a dime. After that, that was the number one selling store in the nation. For that product. They went from selling zero to being the number one selling store in the nation. Use that information to your advantage, okay?